Hachette Audio presents Blood, Fire, and Gold, the story of Elizabeth I and Catherine de' Medici, written by Estelle Paranque, read by Anna Wilson-Jones.
Prologue. The Art of Making Peace. The day was the 27th of April, 1564, and the English ambassador at the French court, an advisor to Elizabeth I of England, Sir Nicholas Throckmorton, had recently earned his freedom. He had also been invited for dinner by artist de Cossé-Brissac, known as de Gonaud, one of Catherine de Medici's and Charles IX's closest privy councillors. Advisor to one queen, Throckmorton had been drawn into the lair of another. Catherine was the French queen mother and mainland Europe's most influential woman. Wearing his usual gold and black attire, conjuring an air of wealth and dignity, de Gonaud welcomed his guest, for whom he had prepared a replenishing meal. Throckmorton was grateful. After all, he had just spent months in a gloomy cell in a French castle, miles away from the capital, fighting for his release and negotiating on behalf of Elizabeth with the French Queen Mother, who had only recently stopped acting as regent for her son, Charles IX of France. By now, the two women had been at each other's throats for months, and their advisers had been caught in the crossfire. "If only your mistress, Elizabeth, the Queen of England, and Catherine de Medici, the Queen Mother of France, could get along well," said de Gonaud over dinner. "The authority of the Pope could then be extinguished in both countries." After a moment of reflection, the English ambassador conceded that the diminution of the Pope's authority would greatly please his mistress, the Queen. The dinner continued with discussions of more trivial matters. The two men spoke of anything other than Throckmorton's difficult experience as a prisoner of the French crown. But Monsieur de Gonaud had been right. If only these two queens could forge an alliance, if only these two queens could forge an invincible friendship, what then could they not achieve? Together they could rule all of 16th-century Europe. But fate had decided otherwise, and Throckmorton, along with other representatives of both courts, had lost months of their lives that could never be reclaimed. It all began on the night of the 10th of August, 1563. Sir Nicholas Throckmorton was arrested for travelling without a valid safe conduct, a diplomatic permit that would allow him to move freely through the country. This was an insult to the English court, for ambassadors were usually allowed free passage, and the message from France was clear. "Your men are here at our pleasure and will play by our rules." Under escort, he was transferred to the castle of Saint-Germain-en-Laye, 13 miles from Paris, where he was guarded around the clock by rude Bretons. While there, thanks to one of his secretaries who had not been arrested and managed to bribe some of the guards, he arranged for his correspondence to remain undisrupted, perfectly aware that his letters would nevertheless be scrutinized by French officials. But he had no choice but to find a way to resolve his diplomatic incident via correspondence. 3 weeks later, his counterpart and colleague, another English ambassador, Sir Thomas Smith, was also arrested at his habitual residence in Poissy, though he was sent to the castle of Melun, southeast of Paris, for his imprisonment. Smith had a far better experience than his colleague, spending only two rather uncomfortable nights in a cell before being brought back to the capital. On the 13th of September, Catherine de Medici and her son, Charles IX of France, allowed Smith to return to his residence in Poissy. But the arrest was a clear message to the English ambassador. In this country, he was, and always would be, at the French Queen Mother's mercy. On his deliverance day, Smith sent a letter to Throckmorton, lamenting his treatment. He said he had become sick from riding from Corbeil in an extremely cold wind on the previous Thursday, and complained, "I am still ignorant of all things as I was the first day of my imprisonment, my books and papers still locked from me. English matters kept from me. But for the French rulers, this wasn't just a simple show of strength. For Charles and Catherine, it was a clear retaliation, a warning to Elizabeth I, who had re-imprisoned four French noblemen at the Tower of London, having promised repeatedly to release them. And Catherine had other things on her mind too. Her son Charles was now of age, and was therefore able to rule the country without a regency. But was he ready? Catherine didn't think so, and she certainly wasn't ready to renounce the crown herself. After all, she had been successfully acting as regent for the last 3 years, and it was a position that had suited her thirst for power. The bond she had with her son was about to be tested, but she remained resolute, confident that the king would do what was best for the country. On the 12th of August, the young king entered Rouen, and 3 days later, the princes of blood and the whole court followed, joining Charles at the Palais de Justice. In the splendid hall built by Louis XII and the Cardinal of Amboise, Charles sat under a canopy on a throne made of gold and azure, the splendour reminding everyone that he was now King of France in his own right. The Chancellor de l'Hôpital, one of the most influential privy councillors at court, was also in attendance, wearing a long black velvet robe with his white beard looking serious and imposing. As expected, he sat at the feet of the king. When all were gathered, Charles declared that he was now of age and apt to rule the country himself, before hastily adding, "My mother, the queen, will also be in charge of the realm." Catherine then stood and bowed in front of her son. She may have been apprehensive at the shift in power, but she knew she could rely on his love. Charles grabbed her by the arms and lifted her into an embrace. He kissed her on the cheeks and insisted affectionately before everyone that she was still the one ruling the country. This display consolidated Catherine's authority at court, and once proceedings were complete, the Englishman Smith was brought in and received by the French rulers. He immediately inquired about Throgmorton's safe conduct, which had been granted by the French ambassador at the English court, Paul de Foix. "I have changed my mind," said Catherine, her face unmoved. "I never thought that the safe conduct was for Throckmorton, who has done so much evil in this country in the last 2 years by conniving with the Protestants of this country and striving to undermine my authority." Smith tried to respond, but Catherine dismissed him abruptly, cutting him off mid-sentence and sending him away before he could say another word, though he would continue to demand Throckmorton's release on behalf of the Queen of England. During the next audience with the King and Queen and their Privy Council that took place days later, Smith asserted that the Queen of England was surprised that her dear ambassador had been made a prisoner of the French crown. Were these two kingdoms not allies? Catherine repeated what she had already told Smith 4 days earlier, that Throckmorton, who had already been a problematic ambassador in the past, ought not to have come without a safe conduct. She added that as long as the English were keeping the hostages at the Tower of London, she would keep him in a cell in France. After all, if these great nations were to be allies, then both parties needed to show their good intent. It was clear to all who observed them that in these diplomatic shows of strength, Elizabeth and Catherine were using their subjects to go at each other's throats, playing with the lives of men they had at their disposal. They both had something extremely important to prove: their legitimacy and ability to rule in a male-dominated world. The Queen's War had begun 5 years before this diplomatic incident. In 1559, at the Peace of Cateau Cambresi, Elizabeth had inherited her predecessor Mary's humiliation at losing Calais, the last English stronghold in France. It was a vital piece of symbolism, its loss perceived by the English as an unbearable slight. Elizabeth was not ready to renounce Calais as easily as Mary. The peace treaty specified that France would restore Calais within 8 years. If they failed to do so, they would have to pay England 500,000 crowns as compensation for the city. In 1559, as a way of ensuring that the French monarchs would keep their end of the bargain, Elizabeth ordered the capture of several French noblemen. Frederick de Foix, Louis de Saint-Maur, Marquis de Nesle, Count de Laval, Gaston de Foix, Marquis de Trans, and Antoine de Prat, Seigneur de Nantuier, Provost of Paris. They were rounded up and sent to the Tower of London, where they would reside indefinitely. By the time the First War of Religion erupted in France.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.